So you've designed and developed an app. You like it, your designer likes it, and your mom tells she likes it. But then the feedback from the real user starts coming in, and it's mixed. How do you know who's right? Maybe that one user is just being mean, or your mom is lying to make you feel better. Maybe it all comes down to subjective preferences. Good news, it's not. You can adopt a data-driven approach and measure if the app's design is actually good. Hi, I'm Ilya, the founder of Eleken, a product design agency for SaaS. Today we'll discuss usability metrics. Let's start with the basics. To simplify a bit, usability metrics for measuring how easy and effective the product is for users. Most usability metrics are calculated based on the data you collect during usability testing. You ask the users to complete a task, observe, and take notes. A task can be, for example, to find the price for a delivery to Japan or to register on the website. The minimum number of users for measuring usability is 5. Jacob Nielsen recommends running usability testing with 20 users. Let's take a closer look to the most common usability metrics. We'll start with the metrics for effectiveness, namely success score. Basically, it allows us to tell whether the design works at all. Success or completion means that user managed to complete a task that they were given. The basic formula for success score is the number of completed tasks divided by number of total attempts. The success score would be between 0 and 1, or 0 and 100%. 0 and 1 are not just simple numbers. In this binary system, these numbers refer to the task being completed successfully or not. All other specific situations are overlooked. Partial task success is considered a failure. To have a more nuanced picture, UX researchers can include tasks performed with errors in separate groups. For example, the task is to purchase a pair of yellow shoes. The partial success options can be buying a pair of shoes of the wrong size, not being able to pay with a credit card, or entering their own data. Let's say there are 20 users, 10 of whom successfully bought the right shoes. 5 chose the wrong type of delivery, 2 entered their address incorrectly, and 3 could not make the purchase. If we were counting just 0 or 1, we could have a rather low 50% success score. By counting all kinds of partially successful tasks, we get the whole spectrum. Avoid, however, counting wrong address as 0.5 of success and add it to the overall average, as it distorts the result. Each partially successful group can tell us more than general success score. Using these groups, we can understand where the problem lies. When can you say a product has good usability? You don't need 100%. The average score is around 78%. Now, let's move to the second usability testing metric, number of errors. In user testing, an error is in any wrong action performed while completing a task. There are two types of errors, slips and mistakes. Slips are the errors made with the right goal. For example, a typo when entering the date of birth. Mistakes are errors made with the wrong goal, like entering the today's date instead of the birth date. There are two ways of measuring errors. Measuring all of them gives us an error rate. To calculate it, we find the total number of errors and divide it by the number of attempts. It is recommended to count every error, even the repetitive ones. For example, if a user tries to click an unclickable zone for more than once, count it each time. Error occurrence rate focuses on one specific mistake. To calculate it, we need to define all possible slips and mistakes and the number of error opportunities. This number can be bigger or smaller depending on the complexity of the task. After that, we apply the simple formula where we divide the total number of errors by the total number of possible errors. That's our error occurrence rate. Can there be a perfect user interface that prevents people from making typos? Unlikely. There is why the error rate rarely equals zero. Making mistakes is human nature, so having usability testing errors is fine. Only about 10% of the tasks are completed without any mistakes, and the average number of errors per task is 0.7. Success score and error rate measure the effectiveness of the product. Now we move to the metrics that are used to measure efficiency. And the first one is task time. Good usability typically means that users can perform their tasks successfully and fast. The concept of this metric is simple. You take a task time of each user add them up and divide by the number of users. Yet there are some tricks to using it efficiently. When do we have the average time? How do we know if the result is good or bad? There are some industry standards for the other metrics, but there cannot be any for task time. Still, you can find the ideal task time. It's the result of an experienced user. To do this, you have to add the average time for each little action, like pointing with the mouse and clicking, using keystone level model. This system allows us to calculate this time quite precisely. Often, the difference in time will be tiny, but caring about the time tasks is not just perfectionism. Remember, we live in a world where most people leave a website if it's not loading after 3 seconds. Saving those few seconds for users can greatly impact their user experience. So you can use it to compare the results with the older versions of your app or with competitors. Our next metric is efficiency. There are many ways of measuring it. One of the most basic is time-based efficiency, which combines task time and success score. The formula for it is far from more complex than the previous ones, and it will take too long to cover in one YouTube video. If you're interested in getting the hang of it, you can check our recommendation list on the best books on SaaS metrics and start your deep dive from there. Or just leave it to the professional UX designers. For now, let's move to the key satisfaction metrics. There are quite a lot of them, but we'll talk about two that we consider the most efficient. For these metrics, the data is collected during usability testing. The researchers ask the users to fill questionnaire. And the first is single is question. This is one of those easy and genius solutions that every UX researcher loves. Compared to all of those complex formulas, this one is as simple as it gets. After the user completes the task, you ask them to rate it from 1 to 7, from very difficult to very easy. While most task-based usability metrics try to establish objective parameters, SAQ measures the user's subjective feelings on the matter. Why does it matter? Maybe objectively, the task took a user longer to complete, but they had no such impression, so they had no negative feelings toward the app and believed it was easy to use. What if the user just reacts slower in general, or they were distracted for a bit? User's subjective evaluation of difficulty is no less important than the number of errors they made. On average, users evaluate task difficulty at 4.8. Make sure your results are no less than that. For those who don't trust the single question solution and want to know more, there is a list of 10 questions known as the system usability scale. Here, based on the answers, the product gets scored at a scale from 0 to 100. Each question is worth 10 points. This is what system usability scale looks like. In the description, you'll find the link to our article where you can take your time with these questions, as well as check out the formulas where we talked about before. This scale is useful when comparing your product with the others. The average SUS is 68 points. Results over 80 are considered excellent. Now that we've covered the most common metrics, you might ask a more fundamental question. Why care about usability metrics? The basic rule of user research states, conducting 3 user interviews gives us a lot of information on product's usability and the issues with it. So why bother with this quantitative UX metrics? Well, if this is the first time you run user tests, you should stick to qualitative tests, of course. The most important thing is to get to know the users well. However, when a company gets serious about user research, quantitative data comes into play. Why? Qualitative tests gives us valuable insights like users find this website navigation intuitive. Quantitative tests provide us the precise numbers. For example, our redesign makes users do their tasks like 61.5% faster than the old design. If you need to convince someone, maybe even yourself, that the redesign is good, that's how you can do it. On the other hand, if your designers provide you with the numbers that prove that users make more errors and are slower after a redesign, maybe it was not a good idea and you need to come back. Even if you really, really wanted to move that button. We can bet Elon Musk didn't take these metrics into account during his big, then still Twitter rehaul. All in all, once you decide to invest in tracking usability metrics, you'll find out that they can be as valuable as any other SaaS metrics. They show you your progress, keep you from rash decisions, and help you prove yourself that your mom isn't lying. The app is actually good. For now, that's it. Don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe if you find this video useful. See you next time.